And last week we celebrated Easter, and this week I'm going to be sharing a message out of the Old Testament about a time that Israel was rededicating themselves to the Lord. And every time we go through experiences in our life, it's always good to stop for a moment and thank the Lord for what He's taken us through and for the next chapter ahead, and really to dedicate, rededicate oneself to the Lord. This is a number of scripture references on here. I'm not going through all of it, and there's actually a couple more chapters in Deuteronomy, but I will have some slides with some of that, so you might want to write. Did you have a note sheet? Oh, really? I sent that. Okay. You know what I sent? I don't know if I sent it to the wrong email. All right. This is some meaningful quotes. I do not know who all these people were that I'm quoting. this is actually some of these I had gotten off the internet like maybe 8 years ago when I had previously done the sermon, but I've kind of revamped it. He who chooses the beginning of a road chooses the place it leads to. It is the means that determine the end. It's not the ends that determine the means. And then when you have to make a choice and don't make it, that in itself is a choice. Delayed, it's like, oh, just put it off. It'll go away. That's a choice. The words of Eleanor Roosevelt ring true. One's philosophy is not best expressed in words, it is expressed in the choices that one makes. In the long run, we shape our lives and we shape ourselves. The process never ends until we die, and the choices that we make are ultimately our responsibility. I don't know if you've got it yet, but my message is going to be on choices. And we have lots of choices in life to make. Every morning I choose, am I going to get up? I'm going to stay in bed for a little bit longer. And I was like, there's choices we make throughout life, and it just keeps on going. So kind of setting the setting here, the passages that we're going to look at, Moses is giving final instructions to Israel. This is near the end of Deuteronomy. His life is coming to an end, and he's done his work and leading Israel. And he wants to leave them with what God is expecting from them in the Promised Land. Moses will not be going in the Promised Land with them, but he is to deliver messages and sermons. Actually, Deuteronomy is an entire collection of sermons of Moses to the people. And this is one of the last group of sermons that he did to prepare them for life in the Promised Land. And Joshua will be leading them in a ceremony at Shechem when they get into the Promised Land. And that's what we're going to be looking at, is that ceremony, that covenant signing, if you will. It's a interesting how it's laid out in Scripture. Israel is asked to make a decision there that will impact the rest of their lives. So that's kind of the setting. And now I think I have we're going to look at Deuteronomy 30, 15 to 20. And there is other verses that are earlier. Moses has just shared with them blessings and curses from God. If they follow the Lord in these ways and make the right choices, God will be faithful to provide these blessings for them. And if they fail to do that and they choose these sins and this activity, and these are laid out in Scripture, this is what God will do to you. And it goes on, and this is after that. So he says, "See, today I have set before you life and prosperity, death and adversity. For I am commanding you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments, statutes, and ordinances, so that you may live and multiply, and the Lord your God may bless you in the land you're entering to possess. Well, that's good. You know, we want blessings, and the Lord calls us to obedience and in following him. And in our Christian walk today, you know, jumping many years forward to our time, you know, our walk with the Lord, God wants us to be faithful. God wants us to walk uprightly. He wants us to bring glory to him in the choices we make and decisions and the activities we involve ourselves in, even our goals that we strive toward. It needs to bring glory to God. And the Israelites, God wanted them to be an example to the world and also to bring glory to him in the things that they do by following his law. Going on with these verses, 17, but if your heart turns away and you do not listen and you are led astray to bow down to other gods and worship them, I tell you today that you will certainly perish and will not live long in the land you are entering to possess across the Jordan. A warning. God will step aside, and there are lots of calamities that will come upon you. It's interesting. I was reading through that a few times, and I'm thinking the negative events that could happen seem to be much bigger because it's laid out in there of things that could happen, and it's even prophesied of things that actually will and do happen to them later in life, in the exile and so forth. 19, I call heaven and earth as this is like more of my focus passages, these two here. Call heaven and earth as witnesses against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live. When I first preached this message, the title of the message was Choose Life. Choose life. You know, whatever you do, choose life. The other choice is not life. And when Moses did this message to the Israelites, he wanted it to be black and white, very clear. There's no middle road. There's no gray area. You have to choose the Lord and be faithful. You walk with the Lord. If you don't, that is something you don't even want to even think about because... you know, as people of God, you want to be receiving the blessings. You want to be able to have a long, prosperous life and be successful in the land and enjoy it. And this is what Moses was really encouraging them to do. Love the Lord your God. Obey him. Remain faithful to him, for he is your life, and he will prolong your life in the land the Lord swore to give to your fathers Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So the Lord is good, and the Lord is faithful, and he wants to bless. So today, my outline is, come on. Here. In life, we have many choices to make. Israel is asked to choose life. Then there's the covenant signing. It's actually a good thing I didn't have the outline because I changed it a little bit. When the handout that I didn't get out to you, apparently... every space I had in it was either a choice, choose, or choices. I added the covenant signing in this list. We must also make a choice, and this choice results in love, obedience, and prosperity. And then, to be continued, I'm going to let you know up front that this message is going to go on. Today, I'm mainly doing... background information and the first point of the original sermon that I did years ago. And this love, obedience, and prosperity is going to be focused on the next time. I'm just going to be preliminary leading up to those. So in life, we have many choices to make. The choices that we make can significantly impact the quality of life we live. And I can think of, you know, choices this morning we had choices. My daughter chose to spend, I don't know how long she was in the shower. She always takes like hour-long showers. She chose not to do a shower last night. She said, I'm going to do it in the morning. And it's like, well, you know, it takes you a long time. And so she sleeps in till the last minute. Anyway, I got here just in time to have the PowerPoint on. But, you know, we make choices that always will have consequences. It will impact our life in certain ways. And we make the best of those choices. Sometimes we make poor choices. And, you know, we get what comes from making those poor choices. Hopefully we learn that next time I won't make that choice. And that's what I'm trying to help my children to learn is, you know, the choices we make, it's really, you learn in life. You learn from the choices we make. So if you want to do better, you want to be more, like in my growing up, I struggled with time management. I struggled with postponing things. Procrastination, yes. There's always later. I can always do it later. I can just put it off. It's not due yet. It's like I've still got a few hours. I've got days, maybe a few weeks, and then, you know, I have to have a fire under me to get myself to do things. But when you go through life and you realize these are things you struggle with, you learn to adapt to that, and you learn that, okay, I need to have some prodding. I need to have something to motivate me. And sometimes I look forward to, once I get this thing done, I can reward myself. So my girls at home, they're trying to reward themselves before they do things. That doesn't work that way. You know, it doesn't work that way. But anyway, so the choices we make can impact the quality of our life we live. Okay, so, you know, other things I wanted to get in there is, you know, young adults choosing to be, you know, the scripture tells us about certain activities that are really a sin and should not be acted on, such as being sexually involved, possibility of, you know, really changing the future outcome of your life in, you know, ways that you may never even have thought about. Dreams that you had shattered, divorce, you know, some here have gone through that. It's so choices we make really are, can be difficult. And then we have to get over those hurdles. But so beforehand, you want to try to do the wise thing and seek the counsel of those that may have gone down those roads. It's like, I'm at the turning point here. I need to make a decision. And it's always good to pray to God, seek His wisdom, study the Word, and seek other wise people that may have some input that will help on these decisions that we make. Decisions like where to go to college after high school, decisions of, you know, the list really is endless. But certainly, we need to be wise in the things that we do and we choose. But ultimately, and like Israel, there is only one choice that we are called to make that can significantly impact the future of our life for all eternity. And, that's the choice to give your life over to the Lord and allow Him to rule on your throne, thus accepting His sacrifice for your sins and striving to live faithfully to His word. Now, Israel, throughout the wilderness, they were getting ready to go into the promised land, and some of the passages we're looking at, they had a difficult struggle. And at this point, they hopefully are on the right road now and going to be going into the promised land. And it's an exciting time for those people and Joshua leading them. And so it's a situation where Moses is wanting to call them to put the Lord on their heart and to keep him there, and to know that if you want to live a long life, you want the Lord to bless you, you want the good things that can come from, you know, well, things that the Lord has already said he will do. And Moses is pleading to the people, then please live this way in the land. It's for many years between Abraham and the point where Joshua is leading the people, it has been difficult for them. And the promise came to Abraham that his descendants would inherit this land, and finally now they are there. Israel is asked to choose life. Moses has given them many warnings and promises through chapters of, there might be some more, might even be discussed in chapter 27, 28, 29, about what God will do with Israel, both the blessings and curses, as they follow him, or if they don't follow him, the Lord will take you out of the land and put you in a foreign land, and all these things will happen to you there. But he always says that you will learn and you will turn back to me, and I will remember these promises. I will bring these blessings back to you once you turn and come back to me. And so the Lord is going to be faithful in that. He's not like just shutting them off. It's like, that's it. You failed. Done. No, the Lord is there. Even in our walk in the New Testament of the Bible, we are promised that if we fail, we sin in our life, God forgives us. And God is always there to provide that forgiveness. He's always there, but he calls us to come back to him. So God's there with his gift of grace and mercy, but we also have to take the step to receive that. So now here at the end, he calls for a decision between life and death. Choose life is the wise suggestion made by Moses. Choose life. We know, you know, because we've studied the, you know, what happens with Israel, and it's quite interesting. You know, they are taken away into captivity from the land after a number of things that happen with them, and not listening to all the prophets, and the prophets telling them warnings of what, you know, is going to happen. And if you continue down this road, Moses had been given some vision from God that these are things that are going to happen. And Moses kind of already had an idea. And so he was pleading with the people, somehow choose life so that we can prove God, no, you're not going to take us away from this land. I don't know, but that would be what I would like to think, is like that we can change the future events by being faithful now, by doing the right things, by making the right choices. I mean, we can think about possibilities that can happen to us down the road if I do the wrong thing. And I think it's always good to weigh the pros and cons on decisions. If I go this way, what might be the outcomes that I might be facing? If I choose this way, what would happen? So it's always good to think that through. And I think Moses and Joshua were on that for the people. They wanted the right thing. The last sermon, Moses, during those last months of his life, includes a calling for the reconfirming of their covenant with God. And throughout the walk of the Israelites, throughout their journey, God was always calling them to come. And he called them stiff-necked people. You know, Moses pleaded to God about them, and others, and later we read about the prophets that are saying the same thing about the Israel. But really, we think about it, it's kind of human nature to be stuck in our ways, to have an idea of, you know, I'm more important than you, and so I'm first. I get this. I get the best thing. You know, Jesus has come and he wants us to say, the first shall be last. It's like, what? And he wants us to have mercy. He wants us to love our enemies. What? He wants us to do these actions that seem to go against what would be natural in our human activities of our life. And here Moses is encouraging the people to choose the right thing. This covenant signing was to take place officially at Shechem, with the entire nation present after conquering the land. Actually, after shortly arriving in the land. Now, it's interesting because this place has a lot of history, and I'm going to go into some of that history about it. Moses would not be there, so Joshua would be leading the people at that time. The message in Deuteronomy was also not just to the people, but so that Joshua knew what God wanted him to do in the future. And we learned that it's going to be a number of years between now and the time that Joshua actually does take the people into the land. And I think I have it wrong as far as the number of years. I said almost 40 years, but Moses didn't die right at that moment when they get up there. There's like 40 years of time between when the spies went into the land to the time when they actually go into the land, about 40 years. But Moses was alive for a portion of that time. And he was able to go up and scope the land from east of the Jordan, at least. They weren't allowed to pass it over the Jordan yet, and that was the promised land. But Moses, was it Mount Nebo? Where he was actually buried. And they, so during the last few sermons of Deuteronomy, it's like it was probably some of his last months of his life that he preached these sermons to Israel. So now we're jumping forward. Joshua, they are in the promised land, describing the signing of the covenant. You know, this is a quite interesting time in the life of Israel. They're excited to take the land. So they have already gone. That might be a good place to put. I have a couple maps, but they've already come across Jordan. They've already conquered Jericho. Next place was Ai, and from there they traveled kind of northwest up to this place that Moses had told them to go to. And Moses had never been there. He might have been able to see it a little bit from the mountains, but God told him, this is where I want you to go to make these covenant. And the history of this place is important because it goes all the way back to Abraham and Jacob. And so Joshua 8 records Israel confirming the covenant under Joshua's leadership, exactly as Moses instructed them to do. Here at Shechem, the nation as a whole participated in choosing a life of blessing. And then on Mount Ebal, an altar was built. It was instructed that Joshua would build an altar of uncut stones, and that on this altar he would sacrifice to the Lord. And this would be in, dedication for the promised land that he has brought us through, and now he is delivering in his promises, and that we as a nation are going to live in this land in the way that God has asked us to. God was, in a sense, expelling the current residents out of this land because they have defiled the land. They have not lived obediently to God, and they are heathen. They are not following the Lord. And these people, the Canaanites and Hittites and all the ites, that God has said, okay, you are no longer going to be here. This land is going to the chosen people. It's interesting because one of the commentaries I was reading was saying that Israel did not choose God. God chose them. We as believers, as Christians, there's kind of a two-way road here. We choose the Lord, but the Holy Spirit chooses us and inspires us to turn to Him. So it's an interesting dynamic that happens there. Now here, Deuteronomy 27 through 28 is the scripture that describes the ceremony in detail. And I'm not going to read all that, but it's quite interesting. It tells how to do this altar. It tells how to do this stone with the law and where to put it. And comes up here. Six tribes, tells them exactly which tribes will be on Mount Gerizim, which is on the south of the city. And then which six tribes will be on Mount Ebal, which is to the north of the city. And as I was studying this, some of the measurements there is that the valley area between the two mountains is less than 500 yards, I guess. I don't know if it was measured in yards or meters, actually, the one I was reading. But it's not all that big of an area, and it's like a natural amphitheater from one side to the other. So we had the tribes to the north and the tribes to the south, all encamped on these two mountains. The priest would shout the sins that brought a curse, to which all the people of both mountains would repeat, Amen. Now, they would share what the sin was, and they would share what curse you would receive if you do that. And so by them saying Amen, they were accepting that. And so that was a signing of what God is saying. Do this, I will do this. If you do this, then I will do this. And so back and forth they went. One side of the mountain did the blessings, and the other mountain did the curses. Would be quite interesting to see this. So this would have been, like I said, sight to see. And Deuteronomy 27, verse 12, kind of lays that out, the way it was happening. Shechem was a small city between two mountains. It was an ideal place for this assembly, a natural amphitheater. And so here, God had told Moses to tell Israel that when you get there, you're going to come to this location. You're going to recite the law. You're going to pledge to the Lord that you will be faithful in obeying this. And God has promised that He will be faithful to bless them as a nation. And, okay, that's good. So now let me talk about a little bit more about this location and why it's so important. So, well, the name Shechem in the Hebrew means shoulder. And so, some of the scholars are wondering, why is that important? Well, shoulder could be, the weight, carries the weight. The shoulder could represent, the upper back is really the part. It's a physical part of the body. And it also could mean that this is an area that is at the ridge of where the one side to the west, all the water goes into the sea, the Mediterranean Sea, and all the water to the other side goes through the Jordan and down to the Dead Sea. And so that's another thing that they talk about. Now, the name Shechem was actually a son of, starts with an H, Hayor, or something like that, who was someone that Abraham had met and had a big area of this town. And he had purchased, not Abraham, but Abraham's son, Jacob. I think I'm getting ahead of myself because I think I have that on a slide. Let me read these first. Goes by other names over the years. And some of these names are shortened versions of the name. Some of them are names that sound similar in the Hebrew, but are more of a pun to some other words. But I didn't want to go to all that detail. But it is in a land or the area of Samaria. And later they call it Samaria. But so some of these, it's the same town. It's the same location between these two hills, these two mountains. And then when the Romans came in, one of the emperors had, or commanders, one of them came in and they renamed the place. That's what they did a lot of, when they conquered land, some of the cities had two names. There's the Roman name, and then there's the national name that the people knew it by over the years. And so Neapolis was the name that it was called then, which was later kind of distorted into Nablus, which is it today. That's the name of the place today. And there are relics, if you will, places that you can visit that took place in the Old Testament. Abraham was here over 450 years earlier from the time when the Israelites first get there. Jacob had bought this land, and he had dug his well there. He bought this land because he was there. He had a large flock. He had a large gathering of people with him and people, and they... It was an important place to come to. His dad had been here and set up an altar to the Lord just a reply to the vision or the promise that God had given Abraham when he first came in to the land and settled in this area. Jacob bought this land, and he didn't want to be a burden on any of the other people in the land, so he wanted to purchase land away from everybody, but a land that was good for grazing for the crops or for the animals, the livestock, and he wanted to dig a well so that he would not be burdened either on that for them, so that he would have his own water supply. And to this day, that Jacob's well is still there. And there's a place now also where Joseph's bones were buried. Joseph from Egypt they had brought his bones to the promised land. And this was one of these things that was to be done. The Lord actually set it up. So here we have a number of things that were important of this town. And I don't know if you can see it, but it's pretty small, but I put a red circle around Shechem, and Mount Ebal is just to the north of it. Mount Gerizim, that's one of the reasons I wanted to do this. But you can see the one mountain and the other mountain. I had another map that actually showed you the elevation of the mountains, but I wanted to have this because so you can see some of the terrain around. And Jerusalem's over here. This is where Jericho, Ai, and then they traveled up this way to get to Shechem. That was what scriptures tell us is where they went next. And then they continued the taking over the land from there after this covenant. And Mount Nebo is over here. This is the area where Moses was buried, and they had traveled up and down this side a few times throughout the land of Moab there in the wilderness times. But yeah, so that's interesting. Now this next map picture, this is quite interesting. This kind of gives you an idea of what the terrain was like, and this area would be more about where the Joseph's tomb would be. And in this area somewhere, just to the south of there, was the well, Jacob's well. So I got the names right, Joseph and Jacob. Okay, so I was confusing before when I was trying to think. Anyway, so, and this is more of a recent picture, and you can see the sprawl out of all of the buildings. And this area in between here was about 500 yards or so wide. So they would have half of the tribes up on this side and half of the tribes up here. And on top of this mountain is a place, an altar, and an inscription in stone of the law. It's interesting that this mountain is to the north, that they had the curses agreed upon. The tribes up here had to say amen after the curses, where this the tribes on this did the amen after the blessings. And so that's quite interesting. So they did this at that point when they come into the land. And then later on, Joshua's getting older. They've already divided up the territory in the land to the different tribes. Joshua later calls the people back to this location, a reconfirming of this covenant you made years ago and even earlier in the wilderness time with Moses. And even prior to that, way back at Sinai. So this is a time, I think it's really important that we realize that God calls people to remember. It's interesting, Dan had some songs, recalling and remembering what God has done and where he has taken us. And this is important for Israel to recall and remember. And this is one of the reasons why God told them to set an altar here, to put a stone and inscribe some script on it for later generations, so that you can pass that on, what God did here for the people. And it's good to have these in our own life to reflect back to what we might call mile markers, milestones, and think back to the times, the things that God has done in your life and brought you through your journey. So interesting, one of my favorite verses here. So Joshua is really, again, doing the same thing with the people in Shechem and in reading through the blessings and curses. And here he says, "But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river, the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are now living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Yeah, amen. Do we have that plaque up in our wall in our home? It's like one of those things, like, I want to remember. It's like, "But for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And we must also make a choice. As Moses made a suggestion that they choose life, Joshua says, choose the Lord. To not choose the Lord would be a choice for cursing and death. That would be the opposite of what you want to do. You want to live a long life. You want to be prosperous. You want the Lord to bless and provide. So even in our Christian walk, it would be a wrong thing to think, "I am expecting blessings from God if I am harboring sin, if I am purposefully doing things that I know are wrong, that God has told me are wrong, and I am ignoring it, and I am doing what I want." That person should never, ever think that God's going to bless them. It's just not in the scripture that God is going to bless you for disobeying, or not just disobeying, but just for choosing evil over choosing good. He wants to propagate the good behavior. God wants to encourage that. And some people don't understand why in the Old Testament God had such strong rules or laws for certain things. Why, you read about certain activities and the whole community is to stone a person to death for certain things, and it seems very cruel. Certain behavior, and I'm not going to list them all because I might get some people upset, but yet it's in the scripture. But certainly what I'm getting at is the Lord wants to stop these activities, these ways of thinking, before they become too much of a cancer in the people. And he wants the people to be holy, set apart. He wants them to be righteous and following him. And it's not bad. I mean, that's what I would want. Some people say, well, God is too strict. God is too stern about that. He's got to have more mercy and grace on me. He has to be able to allow me to make all my choices that I want to make and yet still bless me. You know, it's not like that. And we read in the Old Testament some of the black and white. It's my way or the highway. Well, oh, shoot. Okay, we just saw a movie. Someone said, there is no highway option on this. You have to do it my way. Anyway, that was in a movie. So, we must decide who we will follow. So here we go. Come on. There never was, since the fall of man, more than one way to heaven. Moses meant the same way to acceptance. That was to follow the Lord, which Paul more plainly has described in the New Testament. And certainly, rejecting Christ would be not a very prosperous thing to do, resulting in hopelessness and eternity away from God, which the Scripture says describes it as a hell. Now, as believers, we want to live our, you know, we want to strive to do good. We want to walk in a way that, you know, we are growing in our relationship with the Lord. We want the presence of God to become more and more plentiful in our life. That should be what we want. We want to be able to increase in that way. But yet, at the same time, we make other choices that, in the New Testament, I remember reading about the Apostle Paul. He says about him being a wretched man. He says, you know, that he struggles to do good. And he struggles in this, and he struggles there. And, you know, and he was almost in a way saying that he would prefer that the Lord would come right now, take me away from this life that I am going through. But yet, the Holy Spirit, God has given to us for a purpose, and that purpose is to help guide us through this life of difficult choices and to give us hope. Receiving Christ is choosing life, resulting in happiness in heaven. It produces love, obedience, prosperity. Now, these are the ones I'm going to get into next. Now, the passage in Deuteronomy 30, 19 and 20 talks about these. And we're going to go back into those in my next message, which is going to be on Mother's Day. I don't know if I wrote that on there. But let's put all these up here. Love, the ability to truly love God and others comes from choosing Christ. And the Scripture tells us that. How can we truly love unless we've been able to experience real love? And to understand that it's not us who loved God first. God loved us while we were a sinner. We didn't earn his love in any way. Israel did not earn God's faithfulness, God's blessing on them. But God has called us to be faithful and respond to his love with reciprocated love. By obedience. So love brings obedience. The desire and ability to obey the Lord grows out of the love for God. It's interesting because one flows into the other. And then a life that is full of opportunities and prosperity is one that is completely devoted to the Lord, obedient, and is faithful. And we are walking with the Lord and blessed by him. So where are you? Have you chosen life today? Is the love of God growing more and more in your life? Do you have within your heart a desire and joy to obey and walk closely with the Lord? I have that desire, but it's hard at times because sometimes it takes work, takes effort, takes energy, and can be mentally draining at times, especially with certain people and certain environments that you might find yourself in. But yeah, no matter where we are, God wants us to be a light in that community. He wants us to be encouraging. We do not want to in any way detract from the Lord and put a stop on spreading God's kingdom in this world. So if there's a stumbling block, and we want to try to remove those stumbling blocks from people in ways by using the scripture to encourage and help. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." John 14, 6. The life, Jesus. God says, choose life. Moses says, choose life. "I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." John 10, 10. Are you experiencing abundant blessings from God in your life today? You know, you think back and you want to focus on God's presence. Things may be difficult. Circumstances you might be facing might be difficult. But we look over what God has done. God is good, He's faithful, and He wants to bless. And He is there to carry us through difficult circumstances. So the application, last slide. We must choose God's way every day over our own or the world's. It's a sort of reconfirming ourselves. I think it's good that we take a moment and realize that throughout this day, I can choose to do wrong. I can choose to not open my Bible. I can choose to not pray. I can choose to be angry. I can choose to, mistreat people. It's not Christian. That's not something we want to do. We want to choose God's way and to reconfirm every day. I had a good friend years ago when I was at my parents' growing up my parents' church, a deacon there. Really respected man in the community and at the church, and he was kind of taking me under his wings and encouraging me. They started a program called Yoke Fellows, and the Yoke Fellows is more like the deacons were taking up-and-coming youth and college kids who were showing potential in ministry. And so the deacons would take one of the Yoke Fellows along with them while, through their ministry. And this one man had said to me, so I don't know if I started the conversation, but something like, we got into the thing. It's like, and I just didn't want to do something. I say, like, I don't really feel like I want to go to the hospital and talk to people. I don't really feel that I want to go knocking on doors and sharing the gospel. Sometimes I wake up Sunday morning and I just don't want to go to church. And then he tells me this. He says, you know what? He says, sometimes Sunday morning I get up and I don't want to go to church. And that totally shocked me. You're a deacon. You're like, this. He says, yes, I have to choose God's way over what I feel like. And every day we have these things. Emotions. We have to get over it. So as Joshua said, choose this day whom you will serve. Okay, there it is, to be continued. So choose who you will serve. And that's what I want us to choose the Lord. It's not all equal different gods out there. Choose one of these gods. They're not all equal. There's only one God. Everything else is false. We can choose to make our own decisions. We can choose to walk our own way, which some people do, and some people get through life fine. But there's only one way that we can really walk in the blessings of the Lord and have that joy that He provides, and that's through Jesus. But it requires us taking the back seat, allow Him to be on the throne of our life. Okay, Well, God bless you, and that's my message today. We have a song. Is it a next slide? I don't know if it's coming up.